So this class is an extension of what we have discussed in the last day. Last day we have talked about diode transistor logic in discrete form. So in fact, we have demonstrated how we can develop one NAND gate using DTL logic family. Now, if you can remember, we do have one diode at the cathode of which you are applying the input. And after that, you do have two different diodes which are connected in serial fashion. And then we have a transistor over there. So very briefly, let me just draw the circuit of DTL logic, which we discussed in the last day. In fact, the circuit was something like that. You have these two diodes in the serial path. And depending upon the number of inputs you are considering, you are providing these inputs. And the negative terminal or the cathode terminal of these diodes. So depending upon the number of inputs, it will be like say VI1, VI2, VI3. And if you have more number of inputs, then you can add the diodes accordingly. And ultimately, this is connected to the base of a transistor, NPN transistor. And it was connected to VCC through a collector resistance. So this is a supply line VCC. You have a collector resistance RC over here, some resistance R. And apart from that, we have another base resistance, which we call RB. And this terminal is connected to some negative supply. So that is all. And the output is taken from this. So that is all about the structure, which we have discussed in the last day. And that is known as the diode transistor logic. And the gate, which you have developed by means of this fashion, is a NAND gate. That means if one of the input is zero, if at least one input is zero, for example, if VI1 zero or VI2 zero or VI3 zero, at least one input, if it is zero, then what happens? You find that this transistor, which we call as transistor T1, so this transistor was cut off, and accordingly, this output potential, output voltage over here, which is taken from the collector terminal, is large, and that is equal to VCC. So if at least one of the input is equal to zero, then this transistor T1 is off, and accordingly the Vout is at logic level high. And on the other hand, if all the inputs, VI1, VI2, VI3, if all the inputs are at logic level 1, then you find that this transistor T1 is in saturation, and accordingly this Vout potential is equal to 0.2 volt or 0.1 volt. That means it signifies logic level 0. That means this particular gate symbolizes a NAND operation. Now that circuit which we discussed in the last class is basically a DTL family in discrete form. So you do have these diodes, you do have this transistor and all these things. Now in the integrated form, this diode, so if I call this diode to be say diode D1, and if I call this diode to be say diode D2, now in the integrated form, this diode D1 is being replaced by means of a transistor. And you find that in the integrated DTL logic family, the fan out of the gate has been increased because of the presence of a transistor over here. So as you know, in integrated form, one diode can be realized by means of a transistor if its base and collector terminal are connected together. So for example, if I have a transistor like this, a BJT like this, you have three terminals, base, emitter, and collector. So this is the base terminal, this is the collector terminal, and this is the emitter terminal. Now, if these two terminals are shorted together, base and collector, if they are shorted together, then eventually this three terminal device is being realized or is modified into a two terminal device, only these two terminals, base and emitter. And depending upon the potential difference between these two, so you know it's an NPN transistor. So if this potential is positive with respect to this, that means if VB potential is positive, then obviously this diode will, this transistor will conduct, and accordingly the current will flow. And on the other hand, if this potential VB potential is negative, then the diode, this transistor will not conduct. So then ultimately, the operation of this transistor is nothing but of a diode. If you just connect this base and collector terminal together. Now this idea, this concept has been implemented in the DTL family. While we are implementing this in an integrated form, the only difference is that the base and collector, they are not connected together directly, but with some resistance. Now, I think it will be better if I go to the next slide for this particular diagram for an integrated circuit DTL gate. Let's start from this point. So this resistance R is now split into two different resistance, like some R1 and R2. Or in the other hand, you can also say that you can have a potentiometer whose one end is varying, and this varying gate is connected to the collector terminal of the transistor. So this resistance R is being divided into two resistance. So if I call this to be, say, resistance, let me call this to be, say, rho R, and say this to be 1 minus rho times R. So the total resistance is R, which is being split into two different resistance, like rho R and 1 minus rho R. And the collector terminal of the transistor is connected over here. Now this transistor will perform the action of this particular diode D1. And obviously the second diode will be there in its place. Coming back to the input side, you do have, say for example, we have implemented a 3-input gate. Then it looks something like that. It is identical, just like a discrete form DTL gate. So these are the different inputs. So I may call this like VI1, VI2, VI3, and so on. And I may call, say, this diode is known as, say, DI1. This diode is DI2. This diode is DI3. Now over here, you do have a transistor, bipolar junction transistor, whose emitter is connected to ground, and the collector terminal is connected to the power supply line through a resistance, which we call RC, collector resistance. And here we do have this resistance RB. Now I may call this diode to be, say, diode T2. This transistor, say, let it be called, say, transistor T1. This transistor is transistor T2. And we are taking the output from this terminal, as usual. So that is a Vout terminal. And this is the power supply line, VCC, over here. Now this modification has been taken place over here. Instead of having a diode over here, you do have a transistor. Now, what is the implication of having a transistor over here? Now, look, when this input, VI1 or VI2 or VI3, when this input is at logic level 0, that means the previous transistor is having a voltage equal to 0.1 or 0.2 volt. that means that particular transistor has entered into the saturation region, then you find that most of the current, because the current which is flowing through this path, now there is a provision for division for the current. One part will be flowing through these diodes and the rest of the part will be flowing as the base current for this transistor. Now if these diodes are on, then you find that most of the currents will be flowing through these diodes. Now the diodes will be on if this cathode potential is at logic level 0. That means if this potential VI1, VI2, VI3, if they are at logic level 0, that means at 0.1 to 0.2 volt, then these diodes will be on and most of the currents will be flowing through this path and a very small amount of current will be flowing through the transistor T1. And ultimately you'll find that this transistor T2 does not get enough base drive so that it can become on. So ultimately this transistor T2 will be in the cutoff region and the Vout will be at logic level high. That means if one of the input is at logic level 0 over here, the output will be at logic level high. So that operation is very much similar which we discussed in the last class. On the other hand, if you find that, for example, let us assume that these two inputs are at floating condition. So right now we are not interested in knowing the status of these two inputs, VI2 and VI3. And let us have a look on this input only, that is VI1. Now, if VI1 is equal to 0, that means if it is at 0.1 to 0.2 volt, then the operation is very simple, that the output is large, that is equal to 5 volt. If the VCC supply is at 5 volt, then the output will be at logic level high, if this is at logic level low. Now, if VI1 is at logic level large, logic level high, that means if VI1 is kept at, say, VCC or so, then this diode DI1 will become off, because the anode and the cathode, so they are having the equal potential almost. So there is no flow of current, so this diode will become off. Therefore, the current which is flowing through this branch, so this current will not find any path to flow through this diode. So this current will be flowing through this transistor T1, and the transistor T1 will be operated in the active region. And since it is operating in the active region, you understand that the base current and the emitter current, they are related by means of IE is equal to 1 plus beta times IB. Because if the transistor is operated in the active or linear region, then the collector current can be written as IC is equal to beta times IB, where beta is the common emitter current gain. And emitter current, which is nothing but the summation of base current and the collector current. So this emitter current can be written like 1 plus beta times of IB. So you just try to imagine that instead of having a transistor, if you do have a diode over here only, just like what we have discussed in the last class. So whatever be the input current to the diode, the output current will be exactly the same. So there is no magnification of the current. If you have simply a diode over here, if the diode is on, if the voltage difference between the anode and cathode of the diode is equal to 0.7 volt, then the diode will be acting as a closed switch and the input current and the output current will be the same. So there is no magnification of the current. However, instead of having a diode over here, if you place a transistor like this, like T1, then there is a magnification between the input and the output of this device. The input current is IB and the output current is IE, that is emitter current. And as a matter of fact, this IE is nothing but 1 plus beta times IB. So whatever be the input current, so instead of reducing this particular resistance, you can enhance the amount of current. So one option to increase this current is to reduce the resistance, because if you reduce the resistance, you have a fixed supply of 5 volt. If you reduce the resistance, then obviously more current will be flowing. So that is one issue. But if I just forget about the reduction of resistance, suppose the resistance value is kept constant, then by placing a transistor over here, an active device over here, you can basically magnify the current. So the base current, that is input current to this transistor, and the emitter current, which is known as the output current for the transistor, they are related by means of IE is equal to 1 plus beta times IB. So if I just approximate this one, so let me just write down. So the base current and the emitter current, so they are related. IE is equal to 1 plus beta times IB. That is the relation in the active region or linear region. Now you can also closely approximate like beta times IB, because if beta is large with respect to 1, so there is a magnification between the emitter current and the base current. So the input current and output current, there is a magnification. Now what additional consequence, what additional advantage we are getting out of that? Now if for a fixed base current, since we are placing a transistor over here, so the emitter current is enhanced since the transistor is operated in the active region. So the current through the diode D2 will also be the same. And if I just neglect this current, if I assume that, okay, the amount of current which is flowing through this resistance is small, then the corresponding base drive for the transistor T2 is also increased. So if I just neglect the current, so neglecting, because that part is very small, we'll eventually calculate that part. So neglecting IRB, this IE1 is eventually IB2. The emitter current of the first transistor, emitter current of the first transistor is also the current flowing through the diode D2, that is ID2. And in fact, you do have two different components over here, that is IRB plus IB2, because there will be a division of current at this particular point. But if I just neglect this current, IRB, then that can be approximated to IB2. And once again, this transistor T2 is in saturation. Now, if this transistor is in saturation, then you can easily find out the corresponding expression for the collector current for a particular value of sigma. And accordingly, since the base drive is large with respect to the previous model, which we discussed in the last class, where we do have only a diode over here instead of a transistor. Now, since the base drive is more over here, IB2, so the corresponding collector current will also be large. And therefore, it can drive more number of gates in the next stages. So accordingly, the fan out can be increased. So these deliberations on fan out can be shown like this. So basically, this is in the next stage. Suppose we do have n number of such gates, which can be driven by this particular gate. So you have VCC over here, you have R. And these diodes are the same. So DI1, so let me call DI1 dashed. VCC R, let me call DI2 dashed. And suppose there are n number of such gates. So these inputs are can be fed to the, or as an input to different logic gates. It's not that all these inputs are the same. So it is connected to some gate, say G11. It is connected to say G12. This is connected to G1n like this. So DIN dashed. So now our job is to calculate the value of n, to find out the expression for n. So last day we have already seen an expression for the fan out for this DTL gate with discrete components. Now let us assume that this current which is flowing through these diodes, remember we have to find out the fan out whenever this transistor, this T2, is in saturation. Suppose this is IL1, suppose this current is IL2, and this current is say ILN. Assuming that we do have uniform supply voltage of VCC, and if these resistances are the same and if the diode properties are the same, then you can safely assume that these load currents will be identical. Now, what about this current? You can easily calculate the amount of this current, because you would have a potential of 0.2 volt when this transistor is in saturation. So this voltage must be 0.2 volt. And at that time, this anode to cathode drop is 0.75 volt. And if I assume that VCC is at, say, 5 volt, I assume that this is at 5 volt, then there is two drop, one at 0.75 volt over here and another 0.2 volt over here, this ground drop. So this drop divided by R, so that will be the load current for each of the driven gates. So we can write IL1 is equal to IL2, just like this. In fact, we do have the same calculation last day as well. So it is like VCC minus, if I write in terms of V sigma, minus VC sat upon R. Now putting the value of VCC to be 5 volt, V sigma to be 0.75 volt, and VC sat to be, say, 0.2 volt. So it is coming like 5 minus 0.95, so that is 4.005 by R. So that is equal to 4.05 by R. And that can be approximated to be, say, 4 upon R. So since this particular gate, so let me call this gate to be, say, gate number 0. If I call this gate to be, say, gate number 0, G0, and it provides the corresponding current to n other gates, to at least one input of n other gates. So that's why the fanout is equal to n. So what about this collector current? So the collector current of this transistor, if I call this current to be, say, IC. Now this IC is having two different components. One is the current which is flowing through this path, which we call IRC. And then the summation of all this n load currents. So we can write IC of the second transistor. So IC2 must be equal to IRC2 plus NIL. Now, what about IRC2? Already we have calculated that part in the last day. Same calculation. Let's assume that RC is equal to, say, 2 kilo ohms. So you have a 5 volt supply here, you have a 0.2 volt over here, VC sat. So 5 minus 0.2, that is 4.8 upon 2 kilo ohms resistance. So 2.4 milliampere. So the same calculation. So IRC2 is nothing but 5 volt minus 0.2 volt and with RC to be 2 kilo ohms. It's like 2.4 milliampere, 2.4 10 to the power minus 3 ampere. So that is about IRC2. So you can write IC2 to be 2.4 into 10 to the power minus 3 plus 4N by R. So that part of the calculation is basically identical what we did last day. And regarding the potential at this point, so if I call this point to be, say, point P, then you can calculate the potential. So this potential with respect to the ground potential is nothing but this base to emitter drop for the transistor T1 plus the anode to cathode drop for this diode B2 and plus the base to emitter drop for the transistor T2. Now, if I assume that these devices are carrying enormous amount of current, then each of these drops will be equal to 0.75 volt. So we can write the expression for VP like you have VB1 base to emitter for the first transistor plus VD2 plus VBE2. So 0.75 plus 0.75 plus 0.75. So that is equal to 2.25 volt. So this potential at point P is 2.25 volt. That is fine. Now we have to calculate the current which is flowing through this transistor T1. So if I call that, okay, this is the base current. If I call this current to be say IB1, and this is the emitter current for the transistor one. So let me call like IE1. Then you can simply apply KVL at this loop. So here, this difference VCC minus VP can be written as the summation of these two voltage drop. So as you know, the collector current is the beta times the base current. So you have a collector current over here, which is called like IC1. So here you do have a voltage drop. Rho R is the resistance. And the corresponding current is nothing but the emitter current over here. Because this current has been segregated into two different components. One is the base current, second one is the collector current. And their summation is once again the emitter current. So rho R into 1 plus beta times IB1 plus 1 minus rho into R into IB1. That is equal to VCC minus VP. So this calculation says that VCC minus VP is equal to the upper resistance was rho R, and the current which is flowing is 1 plus beta times IB1, and the lower resistance is 1 minus rho times R, and the current which is flowing is simply IB1. So that will be equal to this rho R IB1, rho R IB1 can be cancelled. So you are left with rho R beta IB1 plus R IB1. So if you take R IB1 common, then this is 1 plus rho into beta. So from that you can easily find out the expression for IB1. So IB1 is like VCC minus VP divided by R into 1 plus rho beta. That is the expression for the base current for this transistor T1. And now we can calculate the emitter current for the transistor T1. So since the transistor is operating in the active region, then the relation is IE is equal to 1 plus beta times IB. So now we can write IE1 to be 1 plus beta times IB1. So let me just check the expression for IB1. It was VCC minus VP upon R into 1 plus rho beta. Okay, so then it will be VCC minus VP into 1 plus beta divided by R into 1 plus rho beta. Now that expression can be cleverly written like VCC minus VP upon R. That is fine. And this 1 plus beta upon 1 plus rho beta can be written like 1 upon rho plus 1 minus rho by 1 plus beta. You can check the mathematics. This entire thing can be written like this. So 1 plus beta in the numerator, and the denominator you have rho plus rho beta plus 1 minus rho, and ultimately 1 plus rho beta. So this is the expression for the emitter current. for the transistor one. And as you know, this emitter current is equal to the diode current, that is ID2. And if I just neglect for the timing, if I just neglect this current through the resistance RB, assuming that the value of RB is pretty large, so that this current which is being taken away is small, then we can make this approximation that IE1 is exactly equal to IB2. Then the expression what we have got over here is also equal to IB2. That is the base current of the second transistor. Similarly, you can calculate the collector current of the second transistor, keeping in mind that the second transistor T2 is now in saturation. During the calculation of fan out, the second transistor must be in the saturation. So this expression for IC2 is not equal to exactly beta times IB2. Rather, you have some sigma term over here, sigma beta IB2. So that is equal to like, we can put the value over here. Already have calculated VCC to be, VP to be 2.25 and VCC equal to 5 volt. So 2.25 and 5, so 5 minus 2.25 will give you 2.75. So you have 2.75. Then obviously this sigma into beta. Divided by R into rho plus 1 minus rho upon 1 plus beta. That is IC2, which is equal to sigma beta times IB2. Now that can be approximated to, that can be equal to the summation of these N currents, that is NIL, which have already made this calculation, that is equal to 2.4 10 to the minus 3 plus 4N upon R. So that is the expression for IC2. So that can be written like 2.4 into 10 to the power minus 3 plus 4N by R. Because that is the expression for the collector current for the output transistor T2. So from that expression, you can find out the value for N. So that can be written like, so if you do this calculation, so let me take N in one side. So 4N upon R is equal to 2.75 sigma beta upon R into rho plus 1 minus rho upon 1 plus beta minus 2.4 into 10 to the power minus 3. So therefore, N can be approximated, N can be written like, so from here 2.75 by 4, last we have seen that the value is like close to 0.7. So I can, so it's better if I just use the approximation sign over here. Because if it is exactly 2.8, then it will be 0.7. So I can make it like 0.7 sigma beta divided by this R gets cancelled. So rho plus 1 minus rho upon 1 plus beta minus you have 2.4 upon 4, that is 0.6. into R into 10 to the power minus 3. So last day we have got an expression like 0.7 sigma beta minus 0.6 R in 10 to the minus 3. So let me just show you the expression which we got last day. So the last day's expression for the fan out was like 0.7 sigma beta minus 0.6 R into 10 to the power minus 3. So it was with discrete comp. So I think I can show it like N with discrete elements and with integrated circuit DTL gates, if I call like NI. So it is coming like 0.7 sigma beta Now you have this component, you have rho plus 1 minus rho upon 1 plus beta minus this component 0.6 r into 10 to the power minus 3. Now you can readily verify that if rho is equal to 1, if rho is equal to 1, then Ni and Nd being the same. With rho is equal to 1, Ni and Nd, these two are same. So what is the significance of rho is equal to 1? So let me go back to the slide itself. What is the significance of rho is equal to 1? So if rho is equal to 1, that means this entire resistance, I mean this collector terminal of the transistor T1 is connected exactly at the base, because this 1 minus rho component is equal to 0 because rho is equal to 1. So the resistance is not divided. So this collector terminal, this point is connected exactly at the base. And you know, if for a transistor, for a BJT, if the collector is connected to the base, then it will basically act like a simple diode. But here we have made a change. We have divided the resistance R into two different components like rho R and 1 minus rho R. And one thing is very clear, that with rho is equal to 1, the fan out of this integrated circuit DTL gate exactly matches with that of discrete circuit DTL gate. Now let us try to concentrate on this value of Ni. We find that it is equal to 0.7 sigma beta upon rho plus 1 minus rho by 1 plus beta. Now the typical value for rho is like 0.1 to 0.5. That is a typical value. Rho is typically 0.1 to 0.5, within that range. So either 10% to 50% of the resistance is being shared. On the other hand, this 1 plus beta is large. If I call if I consider beta 2 is a 50, then this it will be like close to 50. So in the numerator you have 0.1 or 0.5, and the denominator you have 50. So that value is much small with respect to rho. So therefore, this 1 minus rho by 1 plus beta can be neglected with respect to rho. So we can make another level of approximation. So that is the reason because of which we have written Ni in this particular fashion. So now it can be shown to be 0.7 sigma beta by rho into 0.6 r into 10 to the power minus 3. So the value of fan out changes with respect to the value of rho. So if you reduce rho, so the highest possible value for rho is 1. If you reduce rho, then the value of Ni, that is fan out with the integrated circuit DTL gate, will increase, keeping all the other parameters constant. But sometimes you can also neglect the second component, the 0.6 r 10 to the minus 3. You can simply neglect that component also. In fact, last day we have approximated this fan out to be, say, 0.7 sigma beta only, because we know that the dependence on this R is pretty small on the value of the fan out. But however, here we find that the fan out with the integrated circuit DTL gate is having its dependence on the value of rho. So if you reduce rho, then the value of Ni will be large. So how to reduce rho? That means you are moving this point. This resistance is rho R. So if you would like to reduce this resistance, so you have to move this point. You have to move this pointer towards VCC. That means this resistance will be more, because the total resistance is being divided into two different components, rho R and 1 minus rho R. So if you just move this point towards VCC, so this resistance will be more. And obviously, since this resistance is more, because of the flow of the base current, the corresponding power dissipation over here for this transistor T1 will also be large. So that is one of the disadvantages in order to increase the fan out of a DTL gate, integrated circuit DTL gate. If you reduce the value of rho by any means, then the problem is that the corresponding power consumption could be large. And if you make any attempt to reduce rho, then obviously this base current for the transistor T1 will be large, and accordingly the emitter current will also be large for the transistor T1. And this emitter current is serving the purpose of a base current for the second transistor. So in order to increase the fan out, obviously the base current drive for the transistor 2, that is T2, has to be large. Now when the transistor T2 makes a change, makes a transition from the saturation to the cutoff, from the on state to the off state, then obviously the amount of charge which has been stored in this particular junction has to be removed. So more you insert the current, you know that the current is nothing but the rate of change of the charge accumulation. So I is equal to dq dt. So if you have more amount of current so that this transistor can serve or can drive more number of loads in the following stages, then obviously it will also increase the propagation delay of the gate. So that is another important criteria which you must remember while designing any gate. So one is the power consumption. For any gate, you must require that the power consumption should be as small as possible. Second one is the propagation delay. That means whenever these gates are making a transition from the one state to the another state, from low state to high state, logic 0 to logic 1, then this transfer has to be done as quickly as possible. So if you make any attempt to drive the transistor into deep saturation, that means by making sigma to be say 0.05 or 0.03, as you know that sigma is equal to 1 means the transistor is acting in the active region, and lower the value of sigma, higher the extent of the transistor into the saturation region. So if the transistor T2 is in deep saturation region, then obviously the corresponding collector current will be large for the transistor T2, but at the same time, whenever the transistor makes a transition from the on state to the off state, from the high state to the low state, then you have to extract this amount of charge from the base. And if the transistor is driven into deep saturation region, then to extract that amount of charge, you require more amount of time. That is known as a propagation delay of the gate. So you have to make some compromise over here. However, it is very clear that this integrated circuit DTL gate increases or enhances the amount of fan out. So there could have been two different possibility. Whenever this resistance is fixed, and since we have placed one transistor over here, automatically the base drive for the transistor T2 will be enhanced. There is no doubt about that. Now you can do two different things with this higher amount of base current. One option is that you allow this transistor to move into the deep saturation region. That means you keep the value of N fixed, you keep the number of driven gates fixed, and we may drive this output transistor T2 further into the saturation region, from saturation to the deep saturation region. That can be done by decreasing the value of sigma. But that is not a good alternative. You must want that, okay, with a higher collector current, what we can do is we can serve more number of gates in the next stage. So anyway, you have to make some compromise because of the flow of the more amount of current, the power consumption is also very large over here. So that we have to take into account. And the last feature which I want to mention over here is about this particular potential for this resistance RB. Last time you have seen that this potential is at negative terminal. So this was kept at minus VBV. Now this time this is connected to the ground line. So that's a great relief because you don't require any negative supply. With the positive supply only, you can do all this work. And the value of RB has to be selected in such a way that it can withdraw the amount of charge whenever the transistor T2 makes a transition from the saturation to cutoff. Because when the transistor makes a transition from the saturation to cutoff, then the amount of charge has to be withdrawn. And normally, that is done by means of RC circuit. And your understanding on RC circuit suggests that that transition from one state to another state, from low to high or high to low, is very much dependent upon the time constant of the circuit. So if the RC time constant can be made small, then this transition can be made faster. Now here, whenever the amount of charge has to be withdrawn, when the transistor T2 is making a transition from off on state to off state, from saturation to cutoff, then that has to be done through this resistance RB. So that's why you have to reduce the value of RB so that the time constant, corresponding RC time constant, can be made smaller. But whenever, if you reduce the value of RB, then once again, whenever we do our calculation, we have assumed that the value of RB should be large enough, because otherwise, there is an approximation that this IE1 and IB2, they cannot be same, because if RB is small, then the amount of current which is flowing through this branch cannot be neglected. So accordingly, you have to make a compromise between the value of, I mean, the two different extreme values of RB, whether to select a very large value or to select a very small value. Anyway, so one thing is very clear from this analysis is that if you consider this integrated circuit DTL gate, it will enhance the fan out. That means the number of gates can be driven by a single gate. And that is basically because of the presence of this transistor. Because instead of having a transistor, if you do have a diode over here, then there is no magnification of the current. But because of the transistor, there is magnification of the current. And this current is being provided to the base current for the output transistor. And accordingly, it can serve more number of gates in the next stage for a fixed value of R. Now, before concluding, let me just show you some input-output characteristics for this particular integrated circuit DTL gate, the I/O characteristics. So I think it will be better if I once again draw the circuit, because the last circuit was a little bit clumsy. So that was the circuit which we're talking about. And you do have different inputs over here. Let me just show three different inputs. So this is a supply line, VCC. We call this transistor T1, this transistor T2. And this to be the output terminal. We call this to be RC. This one is RB. And this to be say rho R, this to be say 1 minus rho R. So the overall resistance, if I just consider the overall resistance, that is R from VCC to this point. Overall resistance is R. Now let us try to understand what about the I/O characteristics or the transfer characteristics for this DTL gate. Needless to mention, these are the inputs VI1, VI2, and VI3. So, for finding out these I/O characteristics or transfer characteristics, let us keep all the different inputs, is VI2, VI3, under floating condition, and let us keep VI1 as the active input. So, we will make a change at VI1, and accordingly, we will observe the corresponding fluctuation at the output. Now, what happens if VI1 is at logic level 0? If VI1 is at logic level 0, that means if it is at 0.2 volt, for example, then this diode, so let me call this diode to be, say, DI1. So DI1 will be on. So VI1, if it is at logic level 0, logic 0 means 0.2 volt or 0.1 volt. Then DI1 is on. And the amount of current which is flowing through this path, most of the current will be flowing through this. And very small amount of current will be flowing in this path. So there is a division of current at this particular point. And since DI1 is on, so most of the current will be flowing through this path. And only very small amount, insignificant amount of current will be flowing through this path. And which will make the transistor T2 in cutoff region. And if it is in cutoff, then obviously the output voltage Vout is at VCC. So that is equal to 5 volt. Now we have to find out. So obviously VI1 is very small, like 0.2 volt or 0.1 volt. So Vout will be at 5 volt. There is no doubt about that. Now we have to find out the maximum value of VI1, which will make the transistor T2 off. Because as you increase the value of VI1, because you know this particular gate is doing the operation of a NAND gate. So if VI1 changes its logic from logic 0 to logic 1, and right now we are not bothered about the inputs VI2 and VI3. So if VI1 makes a transition from logic 0 to logic 1, then a point will come when this transistor T2 will be saturated. And ideally, if I consider that VI1 is equal to, say, 5 volt, then obviously this T2 will be saturated and Vout will be 0.2 volt, logic 0. But we are interested in finding out the maximum value of VI1, which can make T2 at the edge of cutoff. That you have to find out. So at the edge of cutoff, this particular difference, VBE2, VBE2 must be equal to V gamma, which is the cut-in voltage for the P-N junction diode. So let me call this voltage to be 0.65 volt. So if it is 0.65 volt, T2 is on the edge of cutoff. If you further increase the value of VB2 beyond this value, make it 0.66, then the transistor starts conducting from cutoff to active. But at 0.65 volt, this is the extreme condition. And let us assume that this transistor is just cut off. So therefore, whatever the base current for the second transistor, that should be equal to zero. So this IB2 must be zero. Let us assume that RB is equal to, say, let it be, say, 5 kilo ohms. Now, if this difference is 0.65, then you can easily calculate what about the IRB. So this IRB is nothing but 0.65 divided by 5 kilo ohms. It will give you 0.13 milliampere. So 0.13 milliampere amount of current, that is IRB. And since it is on the edge of cutoff, so therefore this IB must be zero, IB2 must be zero. So what about ID? So ID is the summation of IRB plus IB2. So that should be equal to 0.13 milliampere. And that is also equal to IE1. So you have 0.13 milliampere of emitter current. So you can understand what about the base current. So base current must be very small, very, very small. Now, under this condition, if I call this point to a point P, what about the potential at point P? So now you understand that the current which is flowing through this transistor or through this diode is very small. So you cannot write like 0.75 and 0.75 because that one is very small, but they are conducting. So the potential at point P, which was as before, VB1 plus VD2 plus VB2. Now on the edge of cutoff, this is 0.7 because since it is conducting, VD2 is 0.7 and VB2 is 0.65. So 1.4 and 0.65, so it is coming like 2.05 fold. So this potential is at 2.05 fold. Now if this potential rises by some amount, then ultimately it will increase the base potential of the transistor T2, and as a matter of fact, the transistor T2 will make a transition from the cutoff state to the active state. So we are interested in finding out the corresponding input voltage which makes this potential at point P to be 2.05 fold. Now when the transistor T2 is in cutoff region, you understand that most of the current which is flowing through this path will be flowing through diode DI1. So therefore, this anode to cathode drop for the diode DI1 must be 0.75 volt because heavy amount of current is flowing through the diode DI1. So that difference is 0.75. Now this potential is 2.05. So what about VI1? What is the maximum possible or maximum allowable value for VI1? That is, I think I can write over here only, okay. So VI1 max, which makes the transistor T2 in cutoff, is 2.05 minus 0.75. That is equal to 1.3 volt. So with these component values, you find that the maximum value for VI1 would have been 1.3 volt. So if it is 0.2 volt, no problem, no harm done. But as it increases beyond 0.2 volt, if it just reaches 1.3 volt at this particular point, then this potential is 2.05 volt. And considering these drops over here, assuming that this VB1 and VD2 is constant, then this potential is 0.65 volt. And that makes the transistor T2 on the edge of cutoff region. If you make any attempt to increase this potential beyond 1.3 volt, then more amount of current will be flowing because the base current will be non-zero for the transistor T2. Now, what happens when the transistor T2 makes a transition from the cutoff to the saturation region? That we have to identify. Now, when the transistor T2 makes a transition from the cutoff to saturation, so in the cutoff region, the IC2 in cutoff is equal to zero. And what about IC2 in saturation? So already we have calculated that part, that is equal to 2.4 milliampere, considering that there is a 2 kilo-ohm resistance over here and V out is equal to 0.2 volt. In the saturation, then it will be 5 volt minus 0.2 volt, that is 4.8 volt upon 2 kilo-ohm, that is 2.4 milliampere. So what about the change in the collector current? So what about delta IC2 from cutoff to saturation? So delta IC2 is nothing but 2.4 milliampere. Then what about this delta IB2? IB2 with cutoff is also zero. But with saturation, you cannot simply write like beta times IC2 upon beta, because you have a sigma term over here. So IB2 with saturation is given by 2.4 milliampere divided by sigma beta. Now let us assume that beta to be say 50 and say sigma to be say 0.85. So 0.85 and 50. So let me do the calculation. It is coming like 42.5, and 2.4 divided by 42.5 will give us 0.056 milli. So 2.4 milliampere with sigma to be 0.85 and beta to be 50, it is coming like 0.056 milliampere. Now for the sake of calculation, we can make it approximately to be say 0.06 milliampere, that is 60 microampere. That is IB2 under saturation. So what about delta IB2? So delta IB2 is equal to 60 microampere. So when the transistor T2 makes a transition from the cutoff to the saturation, the change in the collector current is by an amount of 2.4 milliampere. From 0 to 2.4 milliampere, so the change is 2.4 milliampere. And with sigma is equal to 0.85 and beta is equal to 50, we find that the change in the base current is like 60 microampere. Now, whenever the transistor T2 makes a transition from the cutoff to saturation, remember this base emitter junction. So in cutoff, so let me write like this. So cutoff to saturation for the transistor T2. So if I write like IB2, it is zero here to 60 microampere over here. If I call IC2, zero here, it's like 2.4 milliampere here. What about the VB2? VB2 makes a transition from V gamma to V sigma. What is the value of V gamma? That is 0.65 volt. And what is the value of sigma? V sigma, that is 0.75 volt. Because when the transistor is in active region, we can consider the base to emitter drop to be 0.7 volt. And if it is cut off, then 0.65. So on the edge of cutoff and active, this V gamma is equal to 0.65. And when the transistor is fully saturated, then this base emitter drop is equal to 0.75 volt. So what about the change in IRB? So assume that this resistance to be kept at 5 kiloohms, we have considered RB to be 5 kiloohms. So what about the change of IRB? 0.75 in the saturation region and 0.65 in the cutoff region. So the corresponding change over here is 0.1 volt. And the resistance is 5 kiloohms. So what about the value of delta IRB? So delta IRB from from cutoff to saturation, it's like V sigma minus V gamma upon RB. So with V sigma to be 0.75 and V gamma to be 0.65 and RB to be say 5K, it's like 0.1 volt by 5K. That means it will give you it will be milliampere, and 0.1 by 5 means 1000 by 5, 100 by 5, 20 microampere. So delta IB2 will increase by 60 microampere. Delta IC2 will increase by 2.4 milliampere. And delta IRB will increase by 20 microampere. So all these three enhancement will happen when the T2 makes a transition from cutoff to saturation. Then let me go back to this particular circuit. You find that IE1 is nothing but the summation of IRB plus IB2. So when the transistor T2 makes a transition from cutoff to saturation, IRB will increase by 20 microampere and IB2 will increase by 60 microampere. Then what about the enhancement of IE1? This delta IE1 is 60 microampere plus 20 microampere, because you know that IE1 is equal to IRB plus IB2. So delta IE1 must be equal to delta IRB plus delta IB2. So putting the values, you find that it is coming like 80 microampere. Now, when the transistor T2 is in saturation, remember that T1 is always inactive. Now, since T1 is active, so the emitter current and the base current, they are related linearly. And with the current gain of 50, the corresponding base current variation, you can simply write this delta IB1, because T1 is in active region. So it's approximately, it's not exactly, because it's to be IE1 divided by 1 plus beta. But if I just forget about one term, so 80 microampere divided by beta, beta is 50. So it is like 1.6 microampere. As a matter of fact, the base current for this transistor will increase by 1.6 microampere when the transistor T2 makes a transition from the cutoff to saturation. And assuming that this base emitter drop for the transistor T1 is unchanged, is constant, and this anode to cathode drop of the diode D2 is also unchanged. This is D2. And since you have 1.6 microampere more current in this branch, so that is basically compensated by less amount of current through diode DI1. So initially you have seen that when the transistor T2 is cut off, then the amount of IE1, that is the emitter current, was only 0.13 milliampere. That means the current was 130 milliampere through this branch. Now when the transistor makes a transition, the corresponding variation is of 80 microampere. You have seen that it is 80 microampere. So therefore, in fact, we have written, we can once again add the other term, that is IE1. What about IE1? In cutoff, it was like 130 microampere. With an enhancement of 80 microampere, it will become 210 microampere. We are assuming that VB1 and VD2 are remaining unchanged. So therefore, this difference I mean the amount of current through TI1 is to be limited or is to be reduced by 1.6 microampere. Now, if I assume that this VB1 and VD2, they are remaining unchanged, then what about the potential over here? In cutoff region, we find that this difference is 0.65. And in the saturation region, this difference is 0.75. So the potential at point P, we know that this is VB1 plus VD2 plus VB2. We are assuming that these two are remaining constant, unchanged. Whenever the transistor T2 makes a transition from the cutoff to saturation, these two are remaining unchanged. While VB2 makes the transition from V gamma to V sigma. And accordingly, what is the corresponding fluctuation? That is 0.65 volt to 0.75 volt. So the corresponding change is of 0.1 volt only. So accordingly, VP will increase by 0.1 volt. Now coming back to the circuit once again, now if VP increases by 0.1 volt, assuming that only 1.6 microampere amount of current is flowing less through the diode DY1. Normally this current is in the order of few hundreds of microamperes. Whenever it is on, this diode is on, the current which is flowing through this diode is in the range of hundreds of microamperes. Now, from that hundreds of microamperes, if some 1.6 microampere current is flowing less, then obviously there is no harm for this particular diode. Once again, this difference will be like 0.754. So that difference is also constant. However, this potential is raised by 0.1 volt. This difference is constant. So therefore, this VI1 has to rise by 0.1 fold. So the maximum value for VI1, up to which this transistor T2 was in cutoff, was 1.3 fold. Now VI1 has to increase by 0.1 fold so that the potential at point P can increase by 0.1 volt. So instead of having 2.05, it will become 2.15 volt. So that this base emitter drop of the transistor T2 is kept at 0.75 volt. So at 1.4 volt, you find that the transistor T2 makes a complete transition from the cutoff to the saturation region. So at 1.4 volt, when the input voltage is equal to 1.4 volt, the transistor T2 makes an entry to the saturation region. Now, if you further increase VI1, obviously the transistor T2 will be driven into deep saturation. And that you can also find out, because that potential is equal to 0.75 fold. So accordingly, you can easily find out if this potential at input 1, if this potential increases to 1.6 volt, then you'll find that this diode DI1 cuts off, because this potential VP is equal to 2.25 volt when this transistor T1, T2, they are operating with high amount of current, then obviously that is you have 0.75, so 2.25 volt drop. I mean, the potential at point P will be 2.25 volt. And under this condition, if that potential is raised to 1.6 volt, then the difference is becoming 0.65. So for the diode DI1, at the anode terminal, you have 2.25 volt, and the cathode terminal, you have 1.6 volt. So what is the difference? That is 0.65 volt. And if you further increase this potential beyond 1.6 volt, then what happens? This diode will cut off. And accordingly, you can easily calculate what about the base current which is flowing. And you'll find that the transistor T2 has been driven into deep saturation with a sigma value as low as 0.04 or 0.05. So if you would like to draw the final IO characteristics, I mean the transfer characteristics. So it is VI, and you have V out over here. So initially, when the input was small, obviously the output is kept at large. In fact, that fluctuation can be even more steeper, because you have seen that because of 1.6 microampere amount of less current, and that will reduce further. So let me mark. So as long as this input voltage is at 1.3 volt, the output is kept at VCC of say 5 volt. Now when the input voltage is increased by at least 0.1 volt, that is when it becomes 1.4 volt, then the transistor T2 makes the transition from the cutoff, and it just enters into the saturation region. That means the base to emitter drop for the transistor T2, this drop will be increased by an amount of 0.1, so 0.65 to 0.75. And then this potential, I mean, this is close to 0.2 volt, that is the VCC sat. And if you further increase the value of VI, then a point will come when the value of V out will be very small, and that can be as small as few tens of millivolts. So we are not interested in operating the device, operating the transistor deep into the saturation region, because obviously it will increase the corresponding propagation delay. And accordingly, we need some more time to make the transition from the one state to the another state. So that is all about the transfer characteristics. So let me just write down the name, the transfer characteristics. Obviously, this characteristics has been drawn for some typical values of a DTL gate, transfer characteristics of integrated circuit. Detailing it. Right, so with this, I would like to conclude our discussion on the DTL logic family.